Vitamin D, of course, from a classical standpoint, the deficiency is known to cause rickets, as be exhibited by this child here on the left. When vitamin D was supplied to this child, of course, the rickets would heal, and the child would be relatively normal. As far as rickets in a child or a baby, it can happen, as described in this Japanese trial. You end up with the fontanelles failure to close from either vitamin D and/or calcium insufficiency upon birth, and normal calcium and vitamin D intake, this malady will heal, and the child will have a fairly normal life. Here's a slide that I like to present, done by John Haddad in 1971, where they defined the first valid measurement for 25-hydroxyvitamin D. And they picked three groups of patients here: normal volunteers, biliary cirrhosis, and lifeguards. The normal volunteers were simply normal people, asymptomatic for any disease. They drew blood on them, and they measured to 25D, and it came out to be 27 nanograms. Biliary cirrhosis, because vitamin D is a fat-soluble vitamin, it was intuitive that vitamin D to 25D would be low in those people, and it was. And then in the lifeguards, they had in St. Louis in the summertime, they measured vitamin D, and it was quite high, 64 nanograms, which is representative of what indigenous populations with large sun exposures would be. Now, I think that they made a mistake here. They should have labeled the lifeguards as a quote normal level, not the normal volunteers. The normal volunteers probably had limited sun exposure, no vitamin D intake. The reason they probably didn't do that was because in those days, and as similar today, that the daily requirement for vitamin D is 400 to 600 units, and 400 to 600 units would probably support 27 nanograms per ml, but 400 to 600 units certainly would not support 64 nanograms per ml. To get to those levels, you would need 4,000 or 5,000 or 6,000 units of vitamin D intake per day, and that just did not reconcile with the thoughts of then or now.